Blog Talk Radio.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to another edition of the Stench of Truth Radio. Today, it is my pleasure to have Jeff Wamsley as my guest for more discussion on the Mothman. As you may have guessed, since I've had Andy Colvin on a couple times and various other paranormal researchers who have talked about the Mothman, I am fascinated by the phenomenon. There have been several books written about the Mothman and the phenomenon surrounding it, mostly having to do with UFOs and other paranormal activity in association with the appearance of Mothman. And there are any number of explanations as to what Mothman is, but the generally accepted identification of the Mothman is something akin to a very large man with moth-like wings, lacking a head, with very large red glowing eyes. And this, of course, is most famous for having been witnessed by many people in and around Point Pleasant, West Virginia, in the late 1960s, just prior to the Silver Bridge collapse. But what is not so well known to many people is the fact that Mothman has been seen at various times and places other than in Point Pleasant in West Virginia over the years. And in fact, Jeff Wamsley has several websites that he is involved with, one of which is mothmanlives.com, in which people can actually give their sighting reports. And if you're interested in seeing some other areas and times in which Mothman, or what some people have attributed to be Mothman, has been sighted, you can definitely go to mothmanlives.com, which also links up with a couple other websites. And that would be mothmanmuseum.com and the mothmanfestival.com. So those three websites are very key to anybody who's looking into the Mothman phenomenon. And you can also find out about the museum and tours and the festival. And Jeff is very, very much involved in all of this. And of course, he has written a very definitive book on Mothman called Mothman Behind the Red Eyes, The Complete Investigative Library. What's really good about this book is that it compiles a lot of the original material from newspapers, various articles and drawings of Mothman, photocopies of actual newspaper accounts, that sort of thing from the original witnesses. And also has first-hand accounts from the witnesses, some of the witnesses themselves from the original 1966-1967 time frame, just prior to the collapse of the Silver Bridge. Most of you will be familiar with the movie The Mothman Prophecies, starring Richard Gere, which I thought was a really good movie. The only problem with that was that they sort of combined the characters of Mothman and Indrid Cold into one character, when in actual fact they were two completely different characters, two totally different phenomenon that may or may not have been related to each other in any way. One of the most recent things that Jeff has been involved with is the new documentary called Eyes of the Mothman, and you can find out about that at eyesofthemothman.com. And that documentary is very well made, and it does go into the history and some of the possible origins for the Mothman phenomenon, and lists some of the other paranormal events that were going on in West Virginia in and around Point Pleasant, as well as the Mothman sightings themselves. And So I think that gives us a little bit of background as far as who Mothman is, as far as a phenomenon, but we'll talk to Jeff and we'll get some more ideas as far as some of the ideas about what Mothman represents, where Mothman may come from, and how this fits into the general scheme of the paranormal, how it may or may not relate to UFOs, to the very enigmatic character of Indrid Cold, which, as I said before, was sort of mixed up with Mothman in the movie The Mothman Prophecies, starring Richard Gere. So without any further ado, I'm going to bring Jeff on the line, and we're going to talk Mothman and Point Pleasant and history and a lot of other great and fascinating things. So, Jeff, are you there?
Yep. How you doing, Ted?
Very good. Very good. I'm so glad you could join me today.
Well, I appreciate you having me on the show.
Oh, absolutely. As you heard in my introduction, I'm absolutely fascinated by Mothman.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And especially since Mothman is kind of like a it's almost an enigma even amongst the paranormal phenomena in some
yeah.
ways, because it doesn't really fit into any kind of category that that so-called paranormal researchers would try to fit it into.
Yeah, that's true. It's,
yeah.
There's so many things going on at that time with not just the Mothman sightings and encounters and things like that, but like you mentioned before, there was the Ohio Valley in general in the 60s, the mid to late 60s, was just a hotbed for UFO activity. And then the Mothman stuff started happening. Then you had the Men in Black stuff started popping up. And then you had the Silver Bridge collapse, which all happened within a couple-year time frame. So, it was a compressed piece of history right there. There was a lot going on.
Can you tell us how you became interested in Mothman and if your interest in the paranormal goes beyond this, what other things are you interested in?
Well, I grew up in Point Pleasant, and I remember being in it was either junior high or high school and reading some of John Keel's Mothman Prophecies book, and it was kind of neat because it was like all this stuff took place right pretty much on my street. A lot of the original witnesses lived there. I lived about four doors away from Linda Scarberry and her family, and her husband, her soon-to-be husband, lived across the street, Roger Scarberry. They were kind of like childhood sweethearts, they got married, and of course they were in the car that first night. And so as I got a little bit older, started reading Keel's book, and then, when I was in the music business, I owned a chain of record stores, and of course, being in Point Pleasant, I carried a line of my own shirts and things like that, and I started working on that first book in the late 90s, which was Facts Behind the Legend. I co-authored that book with Donnie Surgeon Jr. But it just, to me, and a lot like what you were saying, it was just a fascinating subject because so many people encountered it. It wasn't just two or three people. So it kind of had more validity to it, and I got to talking to some of these people, and it was kind of a big challenge for me to get to some of the people that would never talk about it, and which was a big hurdle, because when all this happened, a lot of those people just clammed up. They were ridiculed, made fun of, and things like that. So it was a little tough to get some of those people to sit down with me and tell me their story, so it was a challenge, and at the same time it was kind of an interest that I think the older I get, the more interested I am in history, and I always looked at that as a historical time, for Point Pleasant in general. So and I'm still, it's still a fascinating subject, and I meet a lot of different people. As far as anything else in the paranormal, really, I've never really had much interest in some of the other stuff. I get billed, you know, as being in the paranormal field, and we get a lot of paranormal investigators that come to the museum and things like that. So it's a unique position to be in because you get a chance to talk to a lot of different people and stuff.
Yes. Well, you talk about history, and of course, history is a very important part of the Mothman phenomenon, especially
right.
considering that it happened in the late 1960s, which is one of the most tumultuous times in American history.
Yeah.
I mean, you had assassination of Martin Luther King and Bobby Kennedy, and
right.
You just had all kinds of things that were going on. In fact, Project Blue Book was going about its business
right.
at that time. And there was a lot of interest in UFOs in general around the country. I think that might have been like the heyday for that sort of thing, for just weirdness in general. And,
oh, yeah.
You know,
yeah.
around the country. And to have so much of it concentrated in West Virginia like that, especially, as you said, right in your own neighborhood.
Yeah.
I could see that if I had been there, I probably would be in a similar position as you. But,
I was only about 5 years old when all this happened, you know, and
yeah.
I wish I could have been a little older to remember, you know, some of the stuff, but, you know, I remember, you know, my dad had some of the magazines, like the UFO magazines and things like that, because he was kind of interested in it, too. He worked up at the National Guard Armory in the TNT area, which is where a lot of those sightings took place, and, you know, he always had kind of an interest in it, but you know, it's nice to talk to people that are older that you know, remember it just like it, you know, just happened and stuff, you know, the details and things like that. But yeah, it was definitely a different time. You know, it was more of a conservative time, you know, with a lot of the people. You know, a lot of people were afraid to report, you know, their sightings and things like that. So, but it was a different time.
I think maybe you might have run across a lot of that that sort of insular community idea where everybody sort of keeps to themselves.
Oh yeah, yeah.
I think
there's
that's
a lot
true.
Of people that I tried to I've still tried to talk to that I probably never will be able to get them to open up about what happened. You know, they've kind of made it clear that, you know, they admit that they saw it, but that's, you know, that's pretty much it. You know, they're not going to go into detail about it.
Yeah, and I think if they wouldn't talk to a town son like yourself,
right,
man,
right.
they're not going to talk to anybody. So.
Yeah, you know, and I've had several pending interviews and sit downs and everything for that second book that were really solid, you know, pieces of evidence. And, you know, of course, I have to respect their privacy. And I mean, I even offered to present it in an anonymous fashion, and they were, you know, they weren't even agreeable with that. And the funny thing is, you know, I know these people.
Right.
Know, but they knew the books would be worldwide, and I guess they just didn't want the attention, you know.
Yes.
So.
Well, I think that's a testament to the fact that Mothman, the phenomenon itself, is so fundamental to these people, the experience that
all right, yeah.
it definitely leaves a mark on them, for good or bad, that makes
oh,
them
yeah.
not want to talk about it and still affects them years later.
Yeah, so. Most of the people that I've talked to, I mean, not all of them, and, you know, some of the people that I've interviewed totally thought that it was just a giant bird, you know, that it was a huge bird that was indigenous to this area, but then any of the other ones that I talked to said it wasn't a bird, you know, it was more than that, and, you know, they'll pretty much, you know, tell you what they saw, you know, but there's different angles on it, you know, it's, that's what makes it interesting, you know.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. Well, of course, one that a lot of people would be familiar with is the Sandhill Crane theory.
Right.
For what that was.
Well, that Sandhill Crane theory just made a lot of those original witnesses just clam up even more, because you know they had went ahead and you know told about what they had encountered, and then to kind of calm the storm, so to speak, you know, they called in some of it was a professor, I think, from West Virginia University, who came in and said, "Well, no, it was just nothing but a sandhill crane," and of course that offended a lot of those people that you know had went out of their way to put their reputation on the line and stuff, you know, and made them look stupid. So
would have offended me too.
Yeah, if you
somebody told me that.
Yeah, and you know, like I said, there's different theories and different. Different approaches to what people were seeing, but there again, I've talked to people, you know, that said what they saw was just an enormous bird, but then again, I've talked to people who said it was, you know, a man that had wings and red eyes and stuff. So, you know, there's different takes on as to what it was.
Hmm. Yes. Well, let me take a moment here. I did mention the book, and you mentioned your other book that you
right.
co-wrote. I'm gonna mention them both again. The one that I have is Mothman Behind the Red Eyes by Jeff Wamsley, and that one was printed in 2005.
Right.
You can find the books on mothmanlives.com. You can also find Jeff Wamsley's books on amazon.com as well. The second book that Jeff mentioned, he co-wrote with Donnie Sargent Jr., and that's called Mothman, The Facts Behind the Legend, and that's from 2001.
Right.
Also, you can find that on Amazon.com as well. You can also check it, mothmanlives.com, which also has other merchandise there as well. Maybe you can tell us a little bit, because people who are familiar with the Mothman story, you know, they know that Mothman was seen in West Virginia and what have you, but it was associated mostly with what's called by the locals the TNT area outside of Point Pleasant. Maybe you can give the listeners a little historical background on what the TNT area is, and we can get a feel for the place and the area there.
Okay. Well, basically, when World War II broke out, you had the military came in. As a matter of fact, the same company who constructed Roswell was the people who came in and built the TNT area. And the TNT area got its name from where they manufactured TNT for the war effort during World War II. And it's about 3,000 acres up there. It was basically a city, you know, within itself. Very high security. It was a 24/7 operation. You know, they were just churning out all kinds of explosives and you know, TNT and things like that. As soon as the war ended, they just pretty much uprooted and took off. You know, they left it up there. All the buildings and the structures and things like that. During the 60s, it was pretty much vacated, but it's where a lot of the kids would go up, hang out. They were out of the city limits. It's about 5 or 6 miles outside of the city limits of Point Pleasant. But it was also a place where, you know, they could, you know, they could get away from the city, and especially the sheriff and deputies and things like that. Did a lot of drag racing and things like that, but even today, a lot of the structures are still there. But there was one particular building up there, which during the war effort was it was called the North Power Plant, and you can see some pictures and things like that on the internet if you just do a Google search or whatever. But that was the building that a lot of those initial sightings were in and around that building. It's about 3 stories tall. At one time had the big smokestacks. They slowly disassembled those buildings over the years And then I think in 92 or 93, they just pretty much demolished it. You know, they tore it down because a lot of people were, you know, inside there messing around, and it was just a big liability for the state. Mm. So they came in and tore it down. But the original witnesses, you know, all through the 66, 67 area, there were a lot of sightings around that building. People thought that if it was a large bird or a crane, that maybe it was kind of roosting in the top of that building, on the roof or one of the top rooms or whatever. But it was a really eerie-looking building. I mean, it just looked like something right out of a movie set. And I wish it was still there, you know, so people could get an idea of, you know, the feel and the overall size of it and stuff. But thanks to some of the people I went to high school with, they tore it down because, you know, they were up there hanging off the top floor by their ankles and painting their names on the top. And there were actually a couple people that jumped off of the top of the building and survived.
Wow.
And, that may have been due to, you know, whatever they were doing up there and stuff, but the state came in and took those buildings down. There was a north power plant, and then on the other side of the road there was a south power plant. What happened in the long run was the explosives and all that kind of stuff contaminated the ground up there. So during the 80s, that was an EPA cleanup site. You know, they came in and took off, I think it was about 3 inches of topsoil. But that's the TNT area is synonymous, you know, with a lot of those sightings. Now, there were people seeing it in town across the river, you know, in Ohio. So it wasn't just in the TNT area, but that's where most people were looking for it. They were up in that TNT area a lot, and they still are today.
And you have a couple of pictures in your book.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Eyes of the Mothman of the North Power Plant.
Yeah.
And in fact, the very first case that you have in there involves a witness who actually went into the North Power Plant and encountered what he
Bob
thought was
Bosworth, yeah.
Bob Bosworth.
Yeah.
Talks about his encounter inside the North Power Plant.
That was about maybe a week or two after Linda Scarberry and the others were in the car.
I'll tell you what, that's a really eerie story to hear
Bob?
Him tell that. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
What's
a footnote on that story is the guy, it was him and his buddy went in there, Alan Coates. And I remember when I was working on that book and I had to call Alan, I had known him when I was a kid. Actually, I delivered papers to about some of these people, but I remember delivering papers to Alan Coates and his mom and dad. But I had to call him to get permission to use his name in my book, you know. And when I talked to him, I just said, well, you know, do you remember much about it, you know, and things like that. He wasn't going to do a full-blown interview, but he told me that he did a tour of Vietnam before that. When he came back, that's when they saw this thing. And he said that he's seen a lot of scary things in Vietnam, but nothing scared him like that up there in that North Power Plant.
Mm.
So I kind of thought, well, you know, whatever it was, you know. Now, Bob passed away about 2 years ago.
Mm.
And but I, you know, he was very reluctant to talk. But I finally cornered him and got him to sit down with me and talk about that and stuff. But you know, that was he was one of the kind of the unsung interviews there when all that happened. He never really got much publicity or press out like the other ones did, so he kind of stayed under the radar there for a while. But yeah, that was a good one. That was a pretty close encounter there.
Yes, and very eerily described, and much the same as most of the encounters with Mothman. You think, like, you know, when I mentioned before about paranormal phenomenon, usually, you know, like some of the more, you know, common categories of things usually have some ultimate resolution or something like this,
right.
Or
Right.
You know, they present themselves in a way that people can garner some kind of knowledge out of them.
Exactly.
And it's sort of like when people encounter Mothman, it's just sort of like, it's there. That's
yeah.
it.
Yeah, you're right. And
yeah.
most of those people weren't real thrilled about it either.
yeah, exactly. I mean, it left a tremendous mark on these
yeah.
people. Yeah.
yeah.
Which
and
is just
to the
amazing.
Point where a lot of them just didn't want to talk about it, you know, they... you know, with Linda Scarberry. And as a matter of fact, you know, now Linda just passed away about 2 weeks ago. I don't know if you knew that yet or not.
Yes, as a matter of fact, I was going to bring that up. Yeah, as
yeah.
you mentioned her earlier.
And she was one of the key eyewitnesses because it, you know, she's the only one out of the four in the car that night that really has sat down and did any interviews. The rest of them, you know, they just, you know, I don't think it'll ever happen. You know, as
mm-hmm.
far as getting a good solid sit down with them, but and you know she told me on several occasions, you know, I stayed in touch with her. She lived in Point Pleasant, still lived there, and she just told me, you know, point blank, she said, you know, I wish I'd never ever saw that thing, you know.
Mm.
She said I wish somebody else would have saw it, which they did. Other people did see it, but
right.
You know, she just wasn't jumping up and down with joy about, you know, seeing this thing. And most of the people I've talked to, you know, were, you know, they just couldn't really rationalize what it was. If they could have said, well, I know exactly what it was, but they just were puzzled for years.
Right.
As to how to explain really what it was or anything, you know.
Did anybody ever relate to you, any of the witnesses ever relate to you, any other weird phenomenon that they ever experienced, like after their sighting?
Yeah. Yeah, well,
can you give us some
particular
examples there for our listeners?
You know, Linda, after all that happened, everything was really, you know, just always, you know, kind of, I guess, paranoid would be the word. You know, she said that she just always felt a presence. You know, they mm-hmm. lived in a mobile home at the time. So, you know, the TV would start messing up and she'd hear squeaking and squawking noises, footsteps on or footprints on the top of the roof. Some of the other witnesses, you know, mentioned the same thing. One lady in particular, Marcella Bennett, she's in the book too. And she passed away about 3 years ago. You know, lived in a two-story house. She would never sleep upstairs. You know, she always slept downstairs and, you know, just she wouldn't drive at night. She stopped driving after dark altogether.
Hmm.
So, and then of course, you know, the Men in Black stuff, which, you know, that started happening to some of them. Strange phone calls. You know, even John Keel, you know, told me about some of the strange calls and camera film missing, all kinds of stuff like that. You know, that would happen. You know, that happened after all this was going on. So
yeah,
and then there was a few witnesses that were just like, you know, Tom Ury, for example, it's in the book. You know, he told me, he said what I saw was a bird. You know, chased him in his car,
mm-hmm.
caused him to run off the road and things like that. You know, but you know he that's like I said, that's the different type of witnesses and stuff. You know.
Yes, and I think we'll. We'll also get into the Men in Black,
right.
and some of the other phenomena that went on in association with Mothman there. And as you mentioned, I think John Keel was probably the principal investigator. Well, Gray Barker had been involved
right.
as well, but
they were both working together, and they had some sort of a disagreement or whatever. But they were supposed to co-author that book, the first book. And then Keel went his separate way, and then, of course, Gray Barker did the Silver Bridge book. And but, you know, just by knowing Keel and how eccentric he was, and I could see where they wouldn't get along. You know, Keel was, you know, pretty opinionated and stuff. So
mm-hmm.
He never went into details as to what really happened or anything. But I think they just felt that, you know, they should kind of go their separate ways and do their own thing.
Well, kind of in you know, just anecdotally, like from my own experience, I've found that paranormal researchers don't often make good partners when it comes to investigation.
Yeah. It's almost like musicians.
Yes.
I mean, I played music since I was 15, and, you know, once the egos and, you know, the music styles and all that,
exactly.
You know, it's like it works for a little while, and then it gets to the point where it's like, you know, I need to do my own thing, and, you know, so. But, yeah, you're right. It's I've always looked at that area there as, is almost like the, you know, being a musician, you know, it's kind of has its same qualities and stuff.
Yeah, I think that's a really good analogy, actually.
Yeah.
Yeah. You look at the history of certain bands, you can see members coming and going and,
yeah.
You know, the egos coming in and,
exactly.
And
yeah.
Changing things around. So, you know,
right.
It's kind of rare, really, whenever you see paranormal researchers team up for long for anything. General. Yeah.
You don't see it a whole lot. I mean, and you know, I've tried to always stay out of that, you know, any type of discontent or whatever you want to call it, you know.
Right.
I really don't, you know, consider myself, you know, a paranormal researcher because I've pretty much stuck to this one area and stuff. As, you know, as far as ghosts and apparitions and things like that, you know, we get a lot, like I said, we get a lot of those people that come to Point Pleasant, they come to the festival, and that's fine, you know, but I've never had any interest in being billed as a you know, paranormal expert. My books are all basically, you know, a lot of interviews and archives and stuff.
Absolutely.
And that way, you know, people can pick those up and look at them and decide whether they think it's a bunch of bull or if there's something to it. Same way at the museum. I mean,
yes.
We're not standing at the door when you come in and cramming, you know, information down your throat as to, you know, what this thing was or whatever. You know.
And I think that's probably the best way to go because
yeah.
I don't think anybody really has a good answer.
No,
I mean, a definitive one anyway.
Exactly.
I mean, there are good answers, but there's
yeah.
no way to know which one is the right one or not. So.
Yeah, and I get asked that all the time too when I do interviews. You know, what do you think it was? What is your opinion on it as what it was and stuff? And I'm just like in the crowd with everybody else on that. You know, because it's you know. It's kind of up in the air. I don't know. I just know that they saw something. I mean, I can
yeah.
guarantee you that they definitely run across something that was out of the ordinary.
Yeah,
you know,
from your
talking to those people.
From your work, I definitely get the idea that you your primary job and focus is to bring forward information for historical
pretty
purposes.
Much, yeah.
Yeah, and you don't really inject a lot of your own opinion as far as what particular is going on there.
The way I look at it is it's sort of like Fox News. You know, we report, you decide, because
mm-hmm.
a lot of people will. Well, I mean, since Linda passed away and stuff, you know, somebody like yourself is never going to get a chance to talk to her
right.
or some of those other people. So. I thought it would be cool, you know, if I could sit down with them and get their stories and you know. Now, her interview's in the first book. Donnie actually sat down with her and talked to her.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, those interviews and stuff will be, you know, a permanent record as to their testimony as to what happened. But those people, when that happened, were, you know, probably in their 20s, and that's been 45 years ago.
Right.
So now it's starting to die off. I mean, some of those people are, you know, passing away. I can think of probably four or five just in the past two or three years that, you know, have passed away. So
yes. Well, you've certainly done a great service by getting these by getting all of this information together. And
yeah.
I can really recommend this book for someone who's interested in Mothman because...
I appreciate that.
Yeah, well, as I said, I mean, it has a tremendous amount of information in it. I mean, it really
yeah,
is
there's
a
lot of detail in there.
Yeah.
I mean, I ask some detailed questions, you know. And,
absolutely.
And try to. But then there's always questions you think about after the fact, you know, after you've done those books and it's been
sure.
published and everything. You're like, man, I wish I would have asked them... about this or that, and you know, I would go back to her all the time and ask her, you know, yeah, different things and stuff. But
well, I know when I'm done doing the interview with you today, there will, I'll be 10 minutes after I'm finished.
Yeah.
I'll be like, damn, why didn't I ask Jeff that question?
Well, we'll do another interview sometime. Yeah.
Someone in the chat room wants you to tell us about the festival. Now, I am going to bust my leg if I have to get down there this year for the festival.
You're in Pittsburgh, right?
Yeah, I'm practically next door. So
we get a lot of people in the museum from Pittsburgh. There was some people in there this past week.
Yeah, and I want to come down for like a day or two. I want to check out the festival. I want to check out the museum and get to meet you and some of the other people down there that I know who go.
Yeah.
So I'm going to, you know, like I said, I'm going to break my leg if I have to get down there.
Yeah.
But why don't you tell us what you have planned this year for the festival so far? Just give us a general idea of like how it's set up and what kind of things go on there.
Well, the festival, we always have it in September on the third weekend. At least we have for the past 8 years, I think, 8 or 9 years. That way with the weather, you know, it's not too hot, it's not too cold. It's kind of like right in between. But we have the festival. It's turned into almost like a three-day event, a Friday evening, Saturday all day, and then Sunday all day event. And we have it right downtown on Main Street. We started, this will be the 10th one this year. This will be the 10th anniversary of the first one. And we started that festival way back when with maybe, I don't know, 300, 400 showed up, and now it's like 4,000 or 5,000 people show up. And what we do is we have all kinds of vendors. There's, you know, merchandise, authors, paranormal groups. We have guest speakers. Andy Colvin was there, I think, last year, year before. Might have been the year before. And we have like a an open type forum for those guest speakers, and people can meet them and talk to them, ask questions, you know, question and answer session. We have like live bands that are playing, and all kinds of stuff like that. We do a hayride on Saturday night up in the TNT area, which is pretty cool. The bus tours basically we do out of the museum there. We do those pretty much year round, but we do them a few more during the festival and stuff. And also we do some tram rides that go through town because, you know, history is pretty big in Point Pleasant. You know, we've got, like I said, the Mothman Museum. We've got the River Museum. Got Twin Dewey Park. You know, a lot of history with the battles there at Twin Dewey Park. And so there's a lot to do and see. You've got the murals that they just painted on the flood wall, a real nice river theater there and stuff. So it's a pretty cool event, and hopefully this year the weather will cooperate. Every year we've been okay with the weather. So and then we try to keep everything updated on that mothmanfestival.com website. So as far as the guest speakers, it'll be there this year. We're still trying to line all that, you know, that stuff.
Yeah, well, it's kind of early for that, yeah.
John Keel had actually came to a couple of those festivals. He would always show up unannounced, though. But, you know, I would sit there and try to get him to commit, and he never would, but then he would just show up out of the blue. So, you know, we were afraid to really, you know, bill him as going to be there because we thought, well, he's about as unpredictable as the Mothman himself. So we figured if we build John Keel showing up, then if something would come, he wouldn't be there or something.
Right. So. That sounds very much like John Keel.
Yeah.
Having read his book. So.
He did make it to a few of them. And, of course, you know, he lived in Manhattan, still lived in New York. But he would drive to Point Pleasant by himself and just show up. But so I think the dates on that this year are the 18th and 19th, 18th, 19th, 20th. It's that third weekend there. I should know those dates by now, but, you know.
Well, hey, you got other stuff you got going on, too.
Yeah.
I noticed on the Mothman Festival website it said something about an explosive cache blowing up there in the TNT area last year. Do you know any more about that? Like what happened? And
well, you know, the open igloos, there's about 100 igloos up there, and they call them igloos because they're concrete storage units that were built during World War II. But they look like igloos, but they're covered with foliage and trees and all that, because the whole premise for that was, is if Japan or Germany would have flown, got over here, they would have flown over that area up there and never seen anything from the air. Mm. And they're still disguised. You know, you can walk right past one and not know one that you're there. But there's over 100 of those up there, and they still haven't opened it back up. But last May, what the state will do is they'll lease some of those out to private companies. And somebody was storing something they shouldn't have been storing in there, and one of them exploded. It was about 2 o'clock in the morning, I think. And just to give you an idea of the magnitude of the explosion, those walls and those igloos are about 4 foot thick.
Wow.
Okay. And it blew the complete top out.
Wow.
There was nothing left. There was nothing left. So if somebody would have been standing, you know, anywhere close to it, it probably would have just obliterated them. So what happened was that then the ATF came in and got involved, in the state fire marshal and the state police and everything. And so I guess the guy who owned the company that was storing that stuff, you know, he was in a lot of caca, you know.
Mm-hmm. I guess so.
Deep caca. I don't know if they ever caught up with him or not, but so then that made it was off limits for us. We still do the bus tours through there. We just can't get out and walk around and look and stuff until they lift that ban. But it was last May, so it's been almost a year ago that went off. And there's actually a local guy here that went up there and filmed that igloo. If you go on YouTube, and if you type in, I was on here one night, TNT igloo explosion, he does a panoramic. He stands there with his video camera and walks around in a circle and shows the whole top of that, how it got blown out.
Wow.
But it's on YouTube, because I've seen it on there, and I think the key words would be TNT area igloo explosion or something like that.
Oh, excellent.
As a matter of fact, the same guy, he went in the North Power Plant before they tore it down. This would have been probably in probably late 80s, early 90s, and walked through it. And it's on YouTube as well.
Oh, great. That's good.
What's that guy? What is his last name? He was younger than me in school, but I don't know. I mean, you know, he went into there and shot all kinds of footage. It gives you an idea of how big that plant was. A lot of concrete catwalks and all kinds of stuff in there. And, of course, they had big generators that ran in there during World War II, so there's all kinds of these empty pits, and you can see where all the machinery was. But Don, I can't think of his last name. I keep wanting to say Maynard. Don McDade, I think was his name. So that might help you find it, too. But he was in the right place at the right time, you know.
Yes.
And all that footage and stuff.
Yeah, that's great. Well, I'm definitely going to check that out on YouTube and see if I can find those videos.
Yeah.
And you also have the museum as well. Tell us how the museum's set up and what you got going on there.
Well, let's see, the museum, can you hear that in the phone line, that cell phone signal? It must be one of my cell phones. Can you hear it?
Like a little intermittent sort of staticky sound?
Let me get on my other phone here real quick. Hold on a second.
Okay, sure.
Can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
Okay. That was a wireless phone that I was on before, and it seems like every time I'm talking, I start hearing that. I hope that's what it is. Maybe it's might be the men in black out here or something.
Well, we're going to get to them in a minute.
Okay. Yeah. As far as the museum goes, basically what happened with that was I had collected a lot of archives, you know, for my books and stuff, and I had those record stores up until about 2003, 2004. Of course, the music industry just took a big nosedive with Napster and CD burning and all that stuff. So I had all those archives in those stores and everything, so I got out of the music business there, but there was a guy from Katanning, Pennsylvania, which is where they filmed the movie. Mm. I think it's maybe about an hour, hour and a half from Pittsburgh.
Yeah, I know where it is.
Yeah, that's where they filmed the Mothman Prophecies.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
He would come to the festival every year and bring – this guy was just infatuated with the whole movie, the Mothman story, and he bought all these props from the movie set.
Mm.
He would get this, he was loaded anyway, he'd go down there and, buy police uniforms that Laura Linney wore, the phones that Richard Gere used in the hotel scene, all that stuff. So he would come down to the festival every year and set up his display and stuff, and people really got a kick out of looking at all of it. It got to the point in later years where he, there was a couple years where he couldn't come, and he kind of just faded out of it a little bit and stuff. So he just called me up one day out of the blue and said, look, this is a big tax write-off for me, and it will help you. So he donated all of it.
Oh, wow. Isn't that great?
Yeah, we're talking a lot of money, and he just called me. He said, my accountant will do this as a tax write-off for me. It'll be a donation to you and who else that helps me. And that's where that idea for the museum came up. But John Keel had always told me that a museum, well, he liked the idea of the festival, too.
Mm-hmm.
But, the museum idea went over pretty good with him, too. So I kind of bounce ideas off of him from time to time and, see what he thought. But so that's how that started. We've been there about 6 years. And we started off with some basic stuff, but I just, constantly picking things up and some rare movie props and a lot of the archives and newspaper clippings and all kinds of stuff like that. So,
mm-hmm. Is there an admission charge for the museum?
Yeah, it's like we've kept it the same for we've never raised it. It's $3 for adults and $1 for kids and under 12, I think. And that basically helps us with to pay the electric and pay to have somebody in there and things like that. I have a gift shop in there, with my merchandise and books,
mm-hmm.
and stuff like that. So,
what a great deal! That's a real
yeah. It's you still get people complaining about $3.
I can't imagine.
Yeah, I know, and I'm thinking, what is the deal? I mean, but and then a lot of people just walk in and just kind of look around and kind of are clueless and then walk out, but. It's got a quirky feel to it. I mean, it's unique. I mean, it's not like you're walking in the Smithsonian or anything. But we kind of build it, and we still do as a museum / research center, where you can come in and sit down and just kind of go through some of the stuff, and we let people take pictures, and every now and then we'll end up on YouTube or something like that. But I had a film crew in there this past Wednesday. Well, it seems like there's one there every week.
Mm.
It was a bunch of college students from Long Island, New York, doing a college project, a video on a documentary on Mothman.
Oh, nice.
And the week before that was the Discovery Channel from Canada. They came in and filmed some interviews and stuff like that. It's for William Shatner's show called Weird or What.
Oh, I didn't know he had I didn't know he had a new show. Is that a new show?
Actually, I think it's been out for a while, but
really?
It plays in Canada a lot.
That's why I didn't hear about it. Yeah.
There again, you go on YouTube and type in William Shatner Weird or What, and it's got some of the episodes.
I'll make a note of that.
Of course, he didn't show up. He wasn't with them. He basically just narrates it. Just sort of a kind of a show where he talks a little bit about the phenomenon and stuff like that. So, but. Yeah, somebody emailed me the other day and said he's worth over $1 billion now with a B.
William Shatner.
Yeah.
well,
and then somebody else made the comment and said the reason is because he owns most of the stock in Priceline.com.
That's interesting.
The website. So.
Yeah. Why wouldn't
live long and prosper?
yeah, he made a good career out of emoting.
Yeah.
That for sure.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yeah,
and even in later years, coming to mock himself, which was kind of funny.
I told Jeremy, the guy that works in the museum for me, it would have been funny if he would have came in there and we could have mocked him, you know, and kind of talk like he did on Star Trek.
Damn it, man, I need more.
Yeah, he'd probably just look at you and say, security, get out of my face. Do you imagine how many times he runs into that on a daily basis, yeah. You know?
That's probably why he doesn't go up in public too much.
Probably, yeah. It would get old after about 20 years of it, you know.
I'll tell you an interesting story about William Shatner, just as a little side note here. A few years ago, I don't even know what I was researching, but I never got a chance to follow up on this, but I was doing some looking into William Shatner and stuff like that. I came across a book that somebody wrote about him. It was a biography, I think, of William Shatner. And in the little synopsis that I read, I'm going to have to look for that again because I've been thinking about it recently and wanted to get it. And he talked about William Shatner taking a bike trip across the United States and how he encountered a UFO in the Southwest United States. And it's something that people don't I've never heard anybody talk about before.
Oh, really?
So, you know, I just wondered, you know, what that experience represented for him and all that stuff, especially considering he was involved with Star Trek and all that kind of stuff, which just, you know, just a little.
I wonder if that happened before or after Star Trek.
Exactly, and I don't know. Like I said, I just saw that little blurb. And I'm going to have to do a look again for that because that would be an interesting little connection, little angle between the two.
Huh.
Yeah, so it's something for people to check out if they want to.
Yeah.
But we'll get back onto the subject now instead of talking about, damn it, Scotty, I need more engine power.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, let's talk a little bit about some of the other witnesses. One of the other witnesses that I thought was a really fascinating one that you have encountered that you have in Behind the Red Eyes is Marcella Bennett.
Yeah.
Maybe you could tell us about that encounter because I think that's really creepy and scary.
Yeah, come pretty close to it. I'd say out of all the people I talked to, what had happened on that is. It's kind of strange. Her maiden name is Wamsley, and
really?
A lot of people, her maiden name is Wamsley because it talks about, if you look at the newspaper clippings and stuff, she went up there with her brother, Raymond Wamsley, and Raymond's wife. So a lot of people always look at that and they say, oh, you related to some of the witnesses and stuff, but there's two sets of Wamsleys here, you know, in Point Pleasant. So I'm not related to her. If I am, it'd be very distantly. Mm. And then also there was a Wamsley that was killed on the bridge when the bridge fell, Marvin Wamsley. And that was totally another, you know. So I always get that asked that a lot, you know, like, oh, you know, that's how you got the inside scoop. You're related to him, but that's not the case. But anyways, what happened with Marcella is her sister, Virginia, her and her husband and kids lived up in the TNT area near where all this stuff took place. So Linda and the other three were in the car that first night, November 15th. Well, the following night, everybody caught wind of all this stuff going on, and Marcella told me that they just thought it was a big joke. You know, they just thought it was somebody up there scaring people. So they were going to go up there to her sister's house and scare the kids because, you know, she had a bunch of nieces and nephews that lived in the house. So she said their plan was to drive up there and they were going to, you know, mess with the kids a little bit and scare them and stuff. So they went
up there. That sounds like something that people would have done back in those days. I remember when I was a kid, the adults would do that kind of thing to us all the time.
and that's why a lot of people thought, you know, it's just somebody up there pranking everybody and all this and that. But
right.
So they went up there, you know, pecked on the windows, blah, 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 you know, had their fun, everything. And they were getting ready to leave. And she had a two-year-old daughter, whom I went to school with. She was a few years younger than me in school. Two-year-old daughter that she was carrying. When she was walking back out to the car, and it was dark, and she said that as she reached down to unlock the car door, this gray figure stood up beside of the car. And she said she just remembered looking at the feet and just working her way up. And she said it was tall. But she said it was standing with its head hunkered down in between its shoulders, just looking at her. Now, I asked her about the red eyes, and she said she did not see any red eyes, but she said it was tall and it was a very broad chested figure, you know. And that's when she got scared, and she took back towards the house. And when she was running back to the house, she tripped and fell, landed on her daughter. And she said she could hear the wings flapping in the background, and she was afraid it was going to come up from behind them and maybe pick up the kid or do something to him or whatever. At this point, all her nieces and nephews were out in the yard just freaking out, running and screaming and everything else. And they all got inside the house, and she said it actually walked up onto the porch. They shut all the curtains, pulled the blinds and everything, but she said it whatever it was came up onto the porch and stayed for a few seconds, and then she said you could hear it flying off.
Wow.
And they called the sheriff's deputies, but remember, it's 6-7 miles out of town, so by the time they got up there, it was long gone. But that was just the night after Linda and them had seen it.
Wow.
And, but she said it was very tall, and she told me she just thought it was somebody dressed up in a khaki-looking clothes. She said it was almost a grayish-brown look to it. But she said its head was down, hunkered down in its shoulders, almost like a bird, you know, a giant bird.
Yeah, yeah. That's immediately what I thought of when you said that in the description that you gave.
And I did get a chance to talk to some of those. Her son, I graduated with her son. He passed away a few years ago, too. The whole family, I think there's just a few of them left. But I just, you know, when I was in high school with those people, I never really made the connection that their parents were the ones involved in the story. But I stopped him one day and talked to him, and he was in the house, you know, when this thing came up on the porch. And I asked him if he remembered anything about it or anything. And he said all he remembered was, you know, the mass confusion and people yelling and screaming and crying. But he said he remembered looking up at the window and seeing a shadow go past the window. And that's all he remembered about it. So, there again, that was real close to where the igloos are now. And that was just the night after. So, you know, for about 2 or 3 weeks, you had real heavy sighting reports and stuff. And Marcella, she's the one I was talking about earlier, that she wouldn't drive at night after that.
Yes.
Her husband worked midnight shift and stuff. And
I think she might mention that, and
yeah.
I think you might have mentioned that in the interview here.
And she was a really, really tough lady. I mean, you know, she could care less what people thought of as far as, you know, her interviews and telling people what she saw. And you know, she told me point blank, she said, you know, I know what I saw. I saw it with my own eyes. And if people believe it, fine. If they don't believe it, it doesn't bother me, you know. But she said, I know what I saw. You know, real, real tough, spirited lady, you know. And her interview, I talked to her on previous accounts and stuff, but her story never wavered, and Linda's never did either. You know, over the years, things kind of get watered down and people change things. And, you know, the way I always looked at it, though, if that whole thing, if it was some sort of a hoax, surely by now somebody would have come forth and said, let's just put an end to all the speculation. You know, here's what happened. Here, you know. But you're right. You know, kids were up there spooking people and jumping out in front of cars and all kinds of stuff like that. You know, I've heard pretty much every theory that you can ever possibly conjure up, you know.
Oh, I'm sure,
all
yeah.
All kinds of stuff, you know.
From the most mundane to the most bizarre, I'm sure.
Yeah. Well, yeah. You know, the military experiment with the jetpack, you know.
Oh,
remember
yeah.
The James Bond movie with the guy
yeah.
flying around with the jetpack on. And, you know, when you think about it, this was during Vietnam.
Mm-hmm.
They're experimenting with all kinds of stuff. They got a guy with a jetpack on and goggles flying
yeah.
around. and, you know, flying over a car, you know, up to 90 miles an hour coming down Route 62. Of course, you know.
Doesn't explain the wings, but...
No, it doesn't.
It's certainly an interesting idea. I think they did, somebody else postulated that for another very famous sighting. I'm trying to remember the name of it right now, but the name escapes me, but perhaps it'll come to me at some point. Yeah, interesting. And of course, John Keel... had his particular theory about the paranormal events that were going on there, and Mothman in particular, which involved what he termed ultra-terrestrials or beings that lived like
UFOs and stuff. You know, he was into that too.
Absolutely.
But, yeah, it was the UFO stuff was just a daily occurrence. Everybody would just see the UFOs. It probably got to the point where people just, you know, just really didn't pay much attention to them. There was a guy named Dave Payton who was a columnist for the Herald-Dispatch, which is in Huntington, West Virginia. And he came to the festival one year because he was here investigating all that stuff, too. But he would write the columns for the paper, and he... With the UFO sightings, he told us that that he devised a system to keep track of when and where and what for all these statistics for the UFOs, and he said he just gave up because there was so many of them. He said he just lost count. There was just so many reports and stuff.
And, yeah.
But that was going on at the same time.
Yes.
Right there where I lived on 30th Street, there's an interview in there with Dolly Grady in that book. She was my neighbor, and she talks about driving into her driveway and seeing a silver saucer flying right over their house in broad daylight. And that was just a few doors down from our house. But she said it just followed her in her car, and then when she pulled in, it just went right over their house. And she said it was just plain as day.
Hmm.
And some of the other neighbors were outside and saw it too. So, really, really strange, you know, stuff going on.
Yeah, and I think that's why Keel kind of like being so inclusive in what he was looking at, put all this together into a sort of broad-ranging theory, you know,
right,
as to what was going on there. And there's certainly been other investigators that have been down there that have looked into the whole thing and have come up with various theories. But I think in the long run, I think the best we can say is that something really, really strange was going on down in West Virginia in the late
50s. Yeah.
There is no question about it.
That lived there at the time, or you know, that still live in Point, and you know, they will talk about that. You know, people were kind of on edge. You know, they didn't know. Well, you know, the grade schools, the elementary schools, during this Mothman flap or whatever you want to call it, they wouldn't let the kids out during recess there for a while because they thought if it was a giant bird that it would come down and pick a kid up, you know, fly off with them and stuff. So. You know.
Yeah, we actually had stories. Some people would call them urban legends up here in Pennsylvania back in the 1980s about giant birds. And so there's one story about a kid who was picked up by a giant bird and actually carried for a short distance. And a lot of speculation.
Happened in Texas
but
that, too, didn't it?
Yeah,
back
I believe
in 76 or whatever.
Yeah, there were a couple of other places. Yeah, and I think Texas was one of them. Yeah. Anecdotally, you know, anyway,
right.
Just to throw that out there for you. And just an interesting little side note. But of course, you know, we've talked about some of the weirdness surrounding Mothman and how it was connected with UFOs. And of course, that then would bring us to the nefarious Men in Black who showed up. And one of the more prominent figures involved with the Men in Black phenomenon was Mary Heyer, who was a reporter who did some of the initial reporting on the Mothman sightings and some of the things that were going on down there. Maybe you can give us a little background on that and tell us how that all developed.
Yeah, Mary Heyer was a reporter for the Athens Messenger, which is about an hour away from Point Pleasant, but they had an office in Point Pleasant. She was the lady that, you know, that had the weekly column in the called Where the Rivers Mingle or Where the Waters Mingle. Back then, you know, you'd have to, Facebook or the website to get on and get all your information. So everybody trusted her, you know. But she, when all this Mothman stuff started happening, you know, she put it in her columns. And that's how a lot of people kept up with the latest and greatest, you know, sighting reports and things like that. But what happened was when John Keel caught wind of all this, he came to Point Pleasant. He told me he was in Kentucky investigating a winged cat sighting, which, you know, he just kind of laughed about. But he said while he was there, he read over the wire about this gigantic bird creature in Point Pleasant. So he said, well, that's on my way back to New York. I'll stop there. But what happened was he ended up staying for months at a time. He stayed right there on 30th Street where I lived with Linda and her family.
Hmm.
And they said, well, you know, you don't need to be staying in a hotel all the time. Why don't you stay with us? So he actually kind of took up residence there with them. Then he would get back to New York. And he told me that he couldn't get anything done. He would go back to New York and try to work on stuff. Then they'd call and say, we saw it again. You need to come back. And so he was just back and forth all the time. But he kind of joined forces with Mary Heyer and some of the other witnesses and stuff. And they kind of, you know, had these roundtable discussions and all this kind of stuff like that. But what started happening with some of those witnesses and Mary herself is they started she had an office downtown in Point Pleasant. She started getting some visits by these men that were dressed in black suits, the black derby hats, the ties, and sunglasses, things like that. And she kind of really didn't know who they were. They didn't really give her a lot of identification. Some people thought maybe they were from the military branch or CIA or FBI or something. But she said their behavior was real peculiar. She, in several interviews and things like that, she talked about, you know, how they would come into her office and she noticed that when she looked at them, that none of them would blink their eyes. They would just sort of a cold stare. And their stance was, you know, you're just causing a lot of panic by putting this stuff in the newspapers. Why don't you just kind of keep quiet about it for now? She would look out her window at night, see him sitting in a black car across the road. And even Linda and some of the other ones and stuff, you know, were talking about these people following, you know, they'd look in the rearview mirror in traffic and see a car behind them with, you know, a couple guys in it. You know, they really stood out, especially in a small conservative town, you know, like Point Pleasant.
Absolutely.
My mother even had talked about seeing some of these men in black, which kind of caught me off guard because this was after my two books had came out, you know, and my mother had came into the museum one day, and as you walk up the ramp in the museum, we have a mannequin standing at the entrance dressed like a man in black.
Mm.
And, you know, a little plaque that tells a little bit about who they were and what people thought they were and things like that. But she came in the museum one day, and she said, what's this supposed to be? And I said, well, it's a man in black, blah, 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 you know. And she goes, oh, I remember them. And I'm like, what are you talking about? You know, I said, I remember seeing these men that dress like this and during this Mothman stuff. And I said, well, where did you see him? She said, down in front of Mary Heyer's office. She said they were always out in front of her office. And I thought that was really weird, you know. And I said, you tell me that now after I finished that book, you know. But, so they did stand out. People did, you know, remember them. You know, being in town and stuff. It's a real tricky area to get people to talk about it. One person in particular that kind of convinced me that this stuff was real was actually Mary Heyer's niece, who still lives in the area. And I had known her for years and didn't realize that she was her niece. You know, I knew who the lady was. And Mary practically raised her, you know, she would stay with her Aunt Mary a lot when she was younger, when all this was going on. So I emailed her one day. I got her email address from somebody, and I just sent her an email. It was just a real, real simple yes or no question. And she knew who I was, you know, from the festivals and the books and all that. And I just said, you know, I'd like to know if this Men in Black stuff really happened. And she emailed right back, and she said it happened. And she said my aunt was very, very concerned. I think that was her exact words. Now, see, Mary died just about 4 years later after all this, you know, of a heart attack. And she was pretty young. She was like 54 years old. She didn't have any kids. Her husband died before she did. So the communication line just kind of broke right there. She had the niece that I talked to, and she had another niece who was an infamous Mothman witness. Her name was Connie Carpenter. And she saw it in broad daylight about 10 miles away from Point Pleasant, up near Mason, West Virginia. She's never granted an interview. I've tried to get to her, and you know, she won't talk about it. So I know a guy who was at her house. She was about 18 years old when she saw it. It was in broad daylight, and when she came back to her house, a buddy of mine's brother-in-law was at her house staying all night with this girl's brother. And they were just, you know, they were just young at the time. And he said she came in and was just, they thought something had happened. They thought somebody, you know, got hurt real bad or killed or whatever, because he said she was just hysterical. So they couldn't calm her down or anything, and he said it just, it scared him, you know, because he said she was just out of control.
Wow.
So that's a first-hand account right there of how upset and scared some of these people were, you know.
Absolutely. Some of them probably more scared by these Men in Black than they were about encounters with
right.
Mothman,
well,
or some of the other things.
And the story goes on with her. I don't know if you've ever seen the documentary, it's Search for Mothman. That was one of the first ones that came out. Sony Pictures financed it. It was sort of a sister project to the movie. And they had, you know, John Keel was on there. But they had Connie Carpenter's boyfriend at the time. He still lives in this area. And they interviewed him, and he talked about the same thing. But what had happened one day is she was going to the mailbox at her house. He said she just clammed up. She wouldn't come out of the house and stayed in her room all the time. Well, one day she went down to get some mail out of the mailbox or whatever, and a black sedan pulled up, and a man got out and tried to pull her into the car, and he said they ripped her sleeve off of her blouse. Just tore the whole sleeve off of her blouse. And he said after that, it was really bad. He said she just wouldn't, you know, wouldn't talk about it or anything. So if you ever get a chance to see that, of course, they don't run it anymore, but we show it at the museum.
You know, it sounds familiar. That story sounds familiar, but
yeah.
I don't know if
Hawk,
I... I'm gonna have to look that up because I don't actually have a copy of it. So
Because It has Marcella Bennett, it has John Keel, I mean, all those people, you know, some of those key witnesses. Now, Linda's not on there, but it's a good one. And you had mentioned Eyes of the Mothman, too, the one that Matt Pulowski did.
Right, right.
Yeah,
that's the newest
that's a good
one that
one.
Just came out, yes.
Yeah.
And you were in there as well, and you were involved in the production of that in some fashion as well, were you not?
I just did interviews and stuff, you know. That was about 5 years ago. It took him 5 years to finish that.
Wow.
He came here 5 years, and maybe 6 years ago. I remember when he first came because, you know, he was really, you know, excited about doing it. And you know, he got involved with some other projects and stuff, and it took him a while to finish it, and I had pretty much just written it off there about a year or two back. And I thought, well, you know, it'll never happen, you know. And he emailed me or called me up, and he said, I've got it finished, you know. And he came last year to the festival, and they premiered it, and it really, a lot of people were impressed by that documentary.
Well, I'll tell you, I have it, and I recommend it for people for a really good historical presentation of a lot of the things that were happening there. And, of course, you can see Jeff Wamsley in there talking about various aspects of the phenomenon as well. So
Yeah, he covered all the bases on that, and it explains a little bit of everything that was going on and stuff.
Yeah. Yeah, and so I can recommend that as well. That's called Eyes of the Mothman.
Yeah.
And you can find out more about that at eyesofthemothman.com. And it's a good documentary. It is, with a lot of information in there. And speaking about the documentary, since you brought it up, one of the things that they go into a lot is the Chief Cornstalk curse.
Right.
No, during like the first part of the documentary itself.
Yeah.
Maybe you can tell the listeners a little bit about that.
Well, Chief Cornstalk, you know, like I said, Point Pleasant's rich in history. And back in the 1700s, I think it was, you know, Cornstalk was a Shawnee chief that was murdered by some of the white settlers and stuff. Him, actually, him and his son both. And over a land dispute, right there in the Point Pleasant area and stuff, where some of these skirmishes took place and stuff. But history has it that you know they had come to an agreement, they backed out on it, got into an argument or whatever, and they shot him and killed him. And up on his dying breath, he said that this town will be cursed for 200 years after he died. And see, a lot of that stuff happened within that 200-year time frame.
Mm.
You had the Silver Bridge collapse. You had this Mothman stuff. You had the jail explosion, which a lot of people don't know about that. That happened in 76. That was, what, 35 years ago.
Mm.
So you had a lot of weird stuff going on with that. Now, other people debate that whole Cornstalk curse. Some people have said that all it was a stage play from the 20s. That somebody had written, and it developed into this. Yeah, developed into a legend type thing. You know, every town has bad things going on and happening.
Sure, stuff. Sure.
I mean, you know, it depends on who you talk to on that. But
Cornstalk was an actual character from history.
Oh yeah, yeah.
And he really was murdered there.
Yeah, he
by
was.
The,
now whether yes. or not he, you know. Whether or not there was somebody standing right beside of him and he said that and it
right.
passed on to each generation or whatever, that would really be hard to prove. But
right.
But Pawlowski's DVD does really cover that pretty good. But
yes.
you know, some people thought that with the bridge disaster and that other kind of stuff that you know, it's always easy to blame something on a curse. I mean, you know,
sure. Sure.
So.
Are there people you know who like put a lot of stock in the idea of the curse, or is it something that's not really encountered too much?
I don't hear a lot of people talking about it all the time, but
mm-hmm.
You know, it's just one of those things. If something happens, oh, it's Cornstalk's curse.
So it's kind of like a catchphrase type of thing, you know?
Yeah, I mean, you
like
know, at least with some of the locals, and even with Mothman, I mean, you know, there's some of the locals that just say, you know,
so they'll say, oh, that's that Mothman again, or something
yeah.
like that.
You know, kind of tongue-in-cheek and stuff.
Very
you know,
interesting,
where,
yeah.
You know, something happens and, you know, they'll say, oh, you know, the Mothman did it or something, you know, stuff like that.
yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, oh, that's good. I mean,
yeah.
You know, it's entered popular culture, so.
Yeah, it has. It's become a worldwide phenomenon. And you know, that skeptics are fine. I mean, you know, we had this last week there when Discovery Channel was there, Joe Nichols came in the museum.
Oh, boy, here we go.
yeah.
he came in
and see, now we did Monster Quest there last year mm-hmm. and filmed some stuff. I did an interview with them, but I never, you know, there again, I never met up with those guys. You know, they probably come to me and think, oh, here's that guy wrote them books and stuff. But you know, he was in the museum last week, but I wasn't in there. Jeremy talked to him some. And of course, the Monster Quest deal, you know, he tried to debunk all the sightings as just hallucinations and people
oh, sure.
just kind of blowing things out of proportion and stuff like that. But there again, I'm not interested in standing around debating stuff for hours at a time on that, you know. But you know, there's been some. I've met a few interesting people and stuff. But
I'm sure, yeah.
You know,
well, for people who don't know, Joseph Nichol is a world-famous debunker.
Yeah,
he classifies himself as a skeptic, but in fact
yeah.
what he does is goes around and tries his damnedest to prove that anything that is not provable by science is simply impossible and the result of people's weird imaginations, hallucinations, and swamp gas.
He's made a career out of that.
Yeah, oh yes, he's very famous.
Really?
He shows up on the Discovery Channel and History Channel and all these shows to prove that everybody's crazy.
Well, who was the guy years ago, the great Randy or something? What was that guy's name?
James Randy,
Randy something. He was
Amazing Randy, yeah.
That's him, yeah.
Yep.
I remember that name, but wasn't he one of those guys that a debunker or whatever?
Oh, yes. He was very famous with PsyCop, Committee for the Investigation of Paranormal something or other. But in actuality, it's just a debunking organization. They try to portray themselves as being scientific, but in fact, they're doggedly materialistic and deterministic. So anything that is not provable by regular scientific means is ipso facto not possible. Mm-hmm. So they go out of their way to prove that various things are impossible by their own, you know, ideas of what science represents. They're all basically charlatans, in my view. I believe in honest skepticism. I think people should approach things with an open mind. You shouldn't go in and just automatically accept, that aliens are coming here from some other planet and taking people into space and this kind of stuff. Because somebody says so, obviously. I mean, you need to be a skeptic about things.
Right.
But those people are not skeptics. Joe Nickel is not a skeptic. He's a debunker. And a debunker is someone who goes out of his way to disprove anything that doesn't conform to his idea.
Kind of a party pooper.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Much so. So he seems like a really nice guy, but I just don't like what he does. And I'm not afraid to say so. And James Randi was in that same camp as well.
Yeah, I remember that name.
Yeah. And he came to prominence debunking Uri Geller, if you remember Uri Geller.
That's the name. You're right.
Yeah.
That was back in the 70s, wasn't it? Or
80s. Yes. The late 70s and the 80s. Absolutely. And that's where he gained prominence. He used stage magician tricks to duplicate his spoon bending, and he could do it, but it simply was unimpressive. And again, just because you can duplicate something doesn't mean that the real thing isn't real. And I'm not trying to say one way or the other whether Uri Geller was the real deal, but the point of the matter is, I mean, if I could, you know, fake a UFO sighting, that doesn't mean that real UFO sightings don't happen. Basically, my point.
Right.
I mean, and he's trying to say, because I can fake what Uri Geller did, that means that Uri Geller's not real.
Exactly.
Which is that's a failed argument, really.
Yeah.
As far as it goes.
But we're what you're saying.
We're getting a little bit off subject there. Sorry about that.
Yeah.
I could go on about supposed a
long
time, because they really get on my nerves, you know, because they're so dogmatic about their approach. It's just crazy.
Yeah.
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 Well, let's see. What did I want to ask you? You said earlier that, if I remember correctly, that you've never had any kind of experiences yourself when it comes to like Mothman or anything unusual happening down there in West Virginia.
Not really?
No. Okay. And that's kind of bizarre for me a little bit, because I find that people who do investigative work and these sorts of things usually have a lot of strange phenomenon that attaches to, you know, and you had talked about John Keel earlier, and certainly John Keel had a whole bunch of strange phenomenon attached to him whenever he started to investigate UFOs and he came to West Virginia. And you had mentioned the weird phone calls and things like that.
Yeah.
And and we had also talked earlier about the movie, The Mothman Prophecies, with Richard Gere. And I had mentioned in the introduction how they kind of confused the two characters of Indrid Cold and Mothman. It's kind of fused them into one for the movie. And you can see shades of different characters in that movie. Right. Like you said, with John Keel and Mary Heyer joining together, it was sort of like Richard Gere's character
exactly.
joining up
yeah.
the police, the woman in the police down there. And,
set in modern day times, it kind of threw everybody off. They were looking for more of a thriller type monster movie and stuff like that. But asking Keel about the movie and what he thought and everything. He didn't really say a whole lot about it. I think he probably just cashed his check and didn't say a whole lot about it. He told me that the way that movie came about. Was there was a guy out in Los Angeles, Richard Hatem, I think was his name, and he's the guy who adapted this screenplay, took the book and adapted it to the movie. But I guess he suffered from insomnia. He was always up walking around looking in bookstores all night long, and he found that Mothman Prophecies book.
Mm.
And then he adapted it to a movie and stuff. And but, yeah, there's... things in the movie like was it Alexander Leak, the guy
yeah.
in the movie,
yeah,
which is Keel spelled backwards.
Yes, mm-hmm. A lot of little inside jokes.
Yeah, it took you a while to figure that stuff out, but
I bet you get a lot of people who come to like the museum and stuff, and they probably base a lot of their information off of that movie, and
it's hard to explain to them, too.
Right, and they're kind of confused about this idea of Mothman and Indrid Cold and anything like that. Have you ever had an opportunity to look into the whole Indrid Cold business with Woody Derenberger?
Well, I talked to Keel about that a little bit. He told me about, he'd went and interviewed him and talked to him and stuff, but that happened only just an hour from here.
That was in Parkersburg,
mineral,
right?
Yeah, Parkersburg Mineral Wells. Matter of fact, we were up that way there last week, right there on Route 77. I don't know exactly where all that happened. But, because Keel's, there's a couple chapters in his book that dealt with all that and everything.
Mm-hmm.
There's so much going on, he was looking into that and Mothman stuff, the other UFO stuff and everything. But, people do... see that movie and they think, they'll walk in the museum and want to know about, did anybody ever die or get killed or anything like that in the movie? There was, the one guy by the tree and all that kind of stuff.
Right, right. Mm-hmm.
He, whenever they started filming that movie, I had my record store at the time, he come walking in the store. He was on his way to film and up there to tanning. He just comes walking in the store one day, and Donnie, the guy that I wrote that first book with, he knew him. He knew who he was from Armageddon, the movie Armageddon. What was the football movie? Remember the Titans? Remember he was the coach?
Yes.
And he just comes walking in there, and he looks just like he does in the movies. And Donnie's like, "That's Will Patton." I was like, "Who's Will Patton?" He's like, "And he heard us." And he turned around. He's like, "Hey, what's up?" He said, "I'm on my way to..." He goes, "I wanted to stop in the town where it really happened and look around." And, we talked to him for a while. And Donnie even drove him up to the TNT area and showed him around up there and stuff.
No, isn't
that
cool?
He was real
cool.
Nice. Yeah, he was real nice,
Well, he seemed like a genuine kind of guy. I mean,
in person like he is. The characters, he's real soft-spoken.
Mm.
Talks real soft and everything and just real friendly. And I guess he lives in North Carolina. And talked about, he likes to write and things like that, and just a real down to earth person and stuff, But
that's cool.
I wouldn't have known him unless Donnie had mentioned that and stuff,
So he's getting into character a little bit by coming down.
Yeah, he was.
Checking
it
out.
I guess he's just kind of walking around, and we should have took some pictures that day. Now Keel came in there a few times too, because I remember I was out of town one day and I. Donnie called me. He worked in the store for me and stuff. And we used to joke around with each other all the time when we wrote that first book, about Keel. John Keel's going to come in here one day, and we're all going to be, meet him and talk and all this and that. Well, he called me up on my cell phone one day. I was about an hour away, and he said, "Guess who's in here right now?" And I just laughed. I said, "John Keel." He goes, yeah, he's in here. And I was like, you're full of it, you know. He goes, he really is. I'm not lying. He is in here. And then I heard John Keel talking in the background. And he said, man, you missed it, you know. And I thought, well, how could I miss that? And he said, well, he's staying all night in town, and he's going to come over and talk to you tomorrow. So I remember I went in the store the next day. I was, like, nervous, you know. I thought, oh, man, you know, what am I going to say, you know. So here he comes walking across the street, and he had his red and black flannel jacket on. He looked like a duck hunter, you know, one of those jackets, those duck
hunters. I know exactly what you're talking about, yeah.
Yeah, and he had one of those hats on with, like, the little, it's just like hunters wear, you know, with the little tassels on the side. And he He comes walking in. I'm standing there looking at him, and he said, are you Jeff? And I said, yeah. He goes, you're in a lot of trouble. You know, just joking with me. So we stood and talked and talked. And what was really cool is, you know, he hadn't seen Linda since all that happened, you know, that for at least 40 years. So I called up Linda, and I said, you'll never, you know, Linda really looked up to him. He was almost like a grandpa to her and stuff. And I said, you'll never guess who's in the store, and it's John Keel. So we set up like a kind of reunion, and we got, you know, they came down there, and I took some pictures and stuff like that.
Oh, that's
so
nice.
It was neat, yeah. It was it was kind of like a historical moment, you know, but, you know, he came in, and, you know, we talked and everything, and I had to get permission from him to for the books, you know, for the quotes on the books and stuff like that.
Right, right, mm-hmm.
And he would actually call me here at home, you know, which really freaked me out. You know, I'd come home and it'd be a New York call, and I would call him and leave a message sometimes on his voicemail, and he would always return my call.
Mm.
And my wife would be like, "Who are you talking to?" I'm like, "John Keel." She's like, "What?" I'm like, "Yeah, you know." So it was neat. I hated that, you know, when he passed away, but you know he wasn't in really good health there and stuff. But
yeah, he was quite a character, and
he was
very.
I've got a bunch of stories, you know, about him that you know, just really, I mean, all good ones and stuff. You know, he was always real cooperative with me, and he just had a quirky sense of humor. He was really dry as far as his sense of humor and stuff. He wasn't afraid to tell you, you know, what his thoughts were on something or whoever or somebody or whatever, you know.
Right.
So.
Yeah, he was very forthcoming, yes.
Yeah, yeah, he
talked
was.
About things, he just sort of laid it all out there.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, you know, I wanted to ask you a little bit about, like, any more recent sightings of Mothman that have, like, attracted your attention.
Well, let's see. I get emails constantly. You know?
I'm sure you do.
Yeah, there was actually one that came a few weeks ago from somebody who had reported. Well, they didn't really report it, but they saw something here in this area, and it was pretty detailed and stuff. But when you get so many of them, you know, it's really hard to validate a lot of that stuff. You know, unless
right.
you've got a lot of time on your hands and the resources and to sit down and talk with those people and stuff. What I knew would happen after that movie came out and after all the TV shows came out and all the exposure that I got, you know, there'd be people coming out of the woodwork, you know, with their, quote, you know, Mothman sightings.
Oh, sure. Mm-hmm.
So it just gets to the point where it's really hard to really verify stuff. And, you know, you don't want to, like you said, you don't want to doubt their story. I mean, you know, because I could be driving down the road tomorrow and run into something, you know, and you'd hope that people would at least believe you. What I've kind of experienced, you know, when I've done those books is the people that don't want to talk about the stuff are usually the ones that are pretty genuine. The ones that won't return your calls, the ones that try to get out of sitting down and doing your interview and things like that. If you get it, everybody else sometimes is like, they're a dime a dozen, you know. Everybody's seen it, you know, here's what I saw and things like that. But, you know, from time to time in the museum, that's always a good place to meet people that have had, you know, you can tell that they're not making stuff up. I mean, they don't really have anything to gain by telling you the story or anything like that. But I get emails all the time, usually daily, We do try to put those on the website. That website is just a monster within itself, trying to keep it updated.
Oh, I'm sure you
all that. You know.
Yeah, I'm sure you probably get a lot of traffic through there.
Yeah.
So in fact, I looked at the one counter and it was like a million or something like that for.
Oh, yeah.
You get a lot of visits there.
It's hard to keep up with it and stuff.
And I'm sure. Do you do all the web work yourself? Or?
Well, we do the updates and stuff. You know, I usually have to hire a 16-year-old kid to come in and show us how to do all the stuff. But we're getting better with it. It's just time is always the worst enemy.
Oh, my God. You telling me, Jeff. Jeez.
Yeah.
Oh,
I teach full time, you know.
I was just going to ask you about that. You actually have a full time job.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, and a lot of people don't realize that most people who are in this sort of business, you know, do paranormal research and things like that. They actually have another full time job that they actually do, which you know really it really does you know. And in my mind, it shows a lot of passion for these people, you know, like yourself, who have a full-time job that they do that earns them a living so they can have a place to live and pay their bills and stuff like that. But they still have the time to put into doing things like this, to do investigations into things.
It's a unique position. I mean, I always, you know, thought when I had those record stores, I thought, you know, nothing can really beat this. I mean, you know, you come as you go and as you want and get all the latest CDs and all those promo CDs they send you for free and all this, get to meet rock stars and stuff like that. And I thought this is really cool. But, you know, there again, the music industry took a nosedive. But I ended up going back into, you know, I have a background in art and design and music and all that. So the graphic design deal is, you know, of course you have to put up with 9th and 12th through 12th graders sometimes, but, you know, that has its moments, and then the museum and all that is just sort of like, you know, it's almost like being in a record store again, because you still have that uniqueness to it and everything, and it's kind of neat, you know, everybody that walks through the door there is different. I mean, you know, we've met so many different people, and we get people to come back on a regular basis. I mean, you know, they come in, you know, every month or two, they'll drive back and come in. And some of the film crews that's been in there, you know, Japanese film crews, Australian film crews, Italian film crews. I mean, it's really been kind of neat.
Hmm. Do you know of any other projects that are going on besides the Discovery one that you were telling us about earlier?
Well, that's the latest one. I get a bunch of emails, you know, from different places. I knew the Monster Quest one would be a big one. That was last year. We did that. Now, the Discovery Channel deal, when they came in, I really didn't talk to them. That show is a 30-minute show, and they feature three different subject areas. So it's probably only going to be 8 minutes of, you know, about the Mothman, you know what I'm saying, because they're going to have commercial breaks and all that.
Yeah.
But they had Joe Nickel. I know they talked to him. They talked to Lauren Coleman.
Mm-hmm.
They brought him in they flew him clear down here from Maine, I guess is where he's at. And that Ken Girard. Those guys are all cryptozoologists, though.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so
yeah, Lauren Coleman is very well known as a cryptozoologist. Yeah,
yeah, so he was on it. But they didn't talk to me, and that was fine. I mean, you know, a lot of times, you know, I'll sit down and do an interview with them and stuff. But, you know, that's fine. I mean, I do enough of it anyway. But as far as any major projects coming up, I'm sure there'll be more. I mean, they just keep coming. And of course, there's a lot of independent ones, you know, the college groups that come in. And I did one with, I've lost track. There's been so many of them I've done, you know, and I'll see myself on TV and I'll be like, I don't remember even doing that. It's weird. I was like, when did I do that? You know, or on YouTube or something. I'm like, I don't, it's like it's another person. Is that a doppelganger or talking, you know, to them? And it's like, I don't even remember talking to them about that or answering those questions and stuff.
Wow.
So, It's weird.
Yeah, it is weird. Maybe you'd like to, if you could, maybe you could tell us, give us a couple of interesting anecdotes or stories that maybe you haven't talked about recently or in other interviews that you've done with people.
There's so many different ones. I've got an email from somebody over in the Middle East somewhere who claimed to have seen this thing, and he just kept badgering me and sending me emails and all this. And then, it got to where he was threatening me for not putting it on the website.
Oh, geez.
He was like, so you don't want to know the truth, that's fine, blah, blah, blah. I had an email there a few weeks ago, a guy from Germany who was wanting to order one of my books, and I told him, we ship in the U.S., but it's more to ship it overseas, so, we'll try to get you a shipping rate. And he got impatient and emailed me back and said, keep your stupid book and all this and that.
Oh, jeez.
One of the stories I don't always tell, but when Keel came to town for one of the festivals one year, this kind of just shows his dry humor and stuff, but we were actually, it was the year that they had the big hurricane somewhere, and it was raining the entire week, so we didn't have the museum at that time, so we were having it inside of where the museum is now. The people that own the low hotel let us use a couple of the storefronts to have it inside, and a couple nights before, he arrived in town and was staying at the low hotel, but we were in there working and trying to get everything ready, but we had the TV monitor in there playing that Search for Mothman DVD that I was telling you about, which he's all over, he's on it and stuff. And there must have been about 10 or 12 people that were in there that had arrived early from out of town that just kind of were hanging out, while we were in there working and stuff. So they're all sitting there watching the DVD, and they're just riveted to the screen, And he comes in, and they all knew him. He comes walking in and sits down and watching it with them. And just kind of reminds you like our grandpa with his grandkids. They're all sitting there watching this documentary. Just, you could hear a pin drop, They watch the entire DVD, and as the credits start rolling up at the screen, they're all sitting there, and they're just waiting for him to say something, And he just stands up and looks at him, and he goes, "What a load of crap!" Like that, and walks off, and they all just started laughing, because they knew who he was. I thought that was funny. I was standing there when he said it. He just looked at him and he goes, "What a load of crap!"
That's classic.
But people really, they treat him with respect. He signed books there during the festival that one day, and I mean, he must have been there for 5 hours.
Wow.
We set him down at a table, and he signed books left and right and stuff. And he would sign this one person, I can't remember who it was. Their book was just all torn and tattered, and the guy probably had read it 100 times, page to page. And when John Keel signed it, I can't remember the guy's name. I think it was like Bill or something, and he come up to me and he goes, "Look, John Keel saw my book." And I'm like, "What are you writing?" It said, "Bill, it said take better care of your books, John Keel." So, he was really a quick-witted,
Yeah, but, I'm sorry I never had a chance to meet myself, because he has a reputation of being a really interesting character. So
he came to town to dedicate the statue, the statue there that's right there where the park is downtown, the famous Mothman statue. And they made a big media event out of it and everything. Comes time for him to pull the big black cloth off of it. They're going to let him do it.
Mm-hmm.
And they can't find him. And he's about three doors down at the little diner there eating. He's breakfast, So they're like, they said, "Jeff, you need to go down there and tell him they're ready to have him unveil the statue."
Mm-hmm.
Because everybody's waiting, they got the film crews there and all the TV crews. So I walk in there and he's sitting there at the little bar thing there with the stools, and he's eating. And I'm like, "Now what, how do I do this?" So I just walk up and I'm like, "Mr. Keel, they're ready for you to unveil the statue, and he said, "You'll just have to tell him that I'm eating, and I'll be there when I finish my breakfast." And I'm like, "What?" He said, "You tell him that I'll be there when I finish." You know, so I had to go back and said, "He'll be here in a minute." Finally, here he come walking around the corner and stuff.
Quite fascinating.
Yeah.
Very interesting guy.
Yeah,
I like that. So, well, we have about 15 minutes left here.
You had mentioned something in your email too about the guy that worked with Pellington.
Yes.
You know, I caught wind of that. You know, of course, I thought it was a joke at first. Maybe it's not. I don't know.
Well, I'll clue people in that are listening. I'm glad you brought that up, Jeff. I completely forgot about it, getting all wrapped up in the stories here. But there was a guy named Masler who was involved with the filming of Eyes of the Mothman. He was like an assistant camera operator.
Yeah,
it was something along those lines. But he was involved in the production of Eyes of the Mothman, the documentary, and apparently this guy had been sought by the police for stalking Ivanka Trump, and
that's Donald Trump's daughter, right?
Yes. Okay. She's pretty good looking too.
Yeah, his wife's Ivana, right?
Right. Yeah.
Okay.
So there might be some confusion there about people, but yeah.
Yeah, it was his daughter.
Yeah, it was his daughter, Donald Trump's daughter.
Yeah.
And a video appeared on YouTube, and it was actually Andy Colvin who pointed me to that. He posted it on his wall on Facebook.
Yeah, yeah.
And I took a look at it, and I'm like, what the heck is going on here?
I know.
And then we found out that he actually worked on the film. And he basically does like a confession where he claims that his stalking of Ivanka Trump was actually caused by the Mothman. He blames Mothman for it.
Yeah.
And I guess at the time he was filming that, he was actually wanted in New York, I think. And
really?
Yeah, and if you look online, you can actually find some information where it shows that he was either arraigned or arrested.
Oh.
If you do a little look.
It's not made up then.
No, it's not. And what I found was really strange about that was because it was right about at the same time, and this is how these weird coincidences usually happen, if you want to call it a coincidence. It was right about the same time that Donald Trump was talking about maybe running for president.
And it seemed...
Like it was really weird because here he is saying that he's thinking about running for president, and then all of a sudden his daughter and this whole Mothman thing and stalkers and everything else and the name gets more coverage in the media and things like that. And I just thought it was weird, and like you, I thought this sounds like a crazy hoax, but in actuality, but in actuality, it appears to be true because I actually read a couple other news accounts where he actually was arrested or arraigned or something like that for actually stalking her. So, I don't even know the story. I mean, as far as what actually he was doing or anything like that, I didn't look into it that much. I just thought it was a really bizarre sort of coincidence that came up with all of it. Yeah.
Matt's never mentioned it. I mean, you know, I get emails from him from time to time, and you know, he stays pretty busy with different projects and stuff. But I do remember that guy. You know,
that was another. Did he seem strange to you at all?
No, not really. I mean, I just remember, you know, Matt, and he had a couple guys with the cameras and one with the sound, and you know,
if you actually go to. If you actually go to Redline Cinemas, that's the company that produced the film. If you actually go to their website, on one of the links there from their main website, they actually have a press release style notice on there about that guy.
Oh, do they?
Yes, okay. They do. Yeah, basically say we didn't have anything to do with this and we're sorry for any you know, whatever that came as a result of it. So it does appear to be like a real thing, and it just seemed really odd to me. And I did want to ask you if you were aware of that or any of the information behind it, because it was just a really strange thing.
Yeah, I did see some of the video and stuff, and there again, nothing really surprises me sometimes, you know. But I haven't talked to Matt about it. I know, you know, when the DVD came out and stuff, you know, I talked to him about, you know, where to get it and all that kind of stuff. I guess it's on Netflix, I think.
Oh, I wouldn't be surprised. Yeah, I didn't check myself. I actually bought a copy off of Tanya Durenberger, who was distributed.
Yeah, okay.
Well, I had her on my show a couple of weeks back, where she was talking about Indrid Cold
and
her father. Yeah. So I bought a copy of the DVD off of her because she had it for sale. So it was, and I had a chance to look at it. And it's very well done. It's very well done.
Good job on it.
Yeah, it's very high production quality, and that's not all that common for documentaries of this type to find a high production quality You know,
he's fairly young too. I mean,
he is.
Stuff,
yes, he is. And you know, in the final minutes that we have left here, I want to tell everybody once again, for information on Mothman, please check out Jeff's websites to find out information about the Mothman Museum, the Mothman Festival, and other information on Mothman from the three websites, mothmanlives.com and mothmanfestival.com and mothmanmuseum.com. And I think all three of those are interlinked as well, are they not, Jeff?
Yeah.
And on mothmanlives.com, there is a place where, as I said before, you can click on in a little menu there, it says sightings, so you can read some sighting reports that people have reported to Jeff through the website. You can find out about Point Pleasant, some of the history there. You can find out some information about Mothman and the museum, and there's also a place where you can buy books and merchandise. And as I said, Jeff's books are also available on Amazon.com if you prefer to go through that route. And again, Jeff is featured in Eyes of the Mothman, which is the most recent documentary that was done on Mothman. And you can find information about that at eyesofthemothman.com. Do you sell the DVD through your website?
We have it at the museum. We just haven't got the link put on there yet, but we will. Yeah.
Oh, okay. So in the future, if you're looking to get the DVD at some point down the road, you might want to check through Mothman Lives or through one of the other websites there of Jeff's, and you should be able to pick up a copy of that documentary through there as well. And
we
sold
out of them when we first got them in, so I had to reorder more of them today.
Oh, very good. Very good.
Yeah.
Well, it's always good. It's always good. So hopefully in the future you'll continue to get more and more interest in the festival and in the museum and your work. And I want to ask you just briefly in the last couple minutes here. Do you think that with all of the renewed attention that Mothman has been given by the various documentaries and all the stuff that people have done about it, do you think that at some point in time we'll have an answer for what Mothman is? Or do you think this is something that's going to remain an enigma?
I think it will remain an enigma. I mean,
you know,
it's been 45 years, and you know, I don't think anybody's going to be breaking out and coming out and saying, you know, because there's so many different theories and you know, different witness accounts and things. It'll be tough. I mean, unless something pops up, you know, somewhere else or, you know, over in another country or something like that, you know, then again, you don't know if that's the same thing that people were encountering here in the 60s or 70s or whatever, you know.
Right.
I don't think it's really limited to just the 60s, but that's when most of the stuff was going on, you know, got most of the attention. But I think it'd be a tough one to crack, you know, as far as really pinpointing exactly what it was. I think that's part of the beauty of it, though, because, you know, it just keeps people's curiosity. It keeps them looking for answers and stuff, you know.
Yes.
It would be kind of boring, I think, if somebody solved it, you know.
Yeah, actually, you know, that you put it that way, I think it would
be.
You know,
yeah,
even
kind of,
if it was a really, even if it was a really weird answer, it still would be mundane, you know, to have it solved. Just to say,
what those people saw was not the norm. I mean, you know, when I talked to those people, I knew that they were describing something that really had them puzzled. Still does.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of them just they just kind of given up and trying to figure out what it was and stuff. But it scared them. I mean, you know, it really shook them up.
Yes. And if you read and like I said, I have a copy of Mothman Behind the Red Eyes. I highly recommend this as a resource for anybody who wants to do research into Mothman, because it does reproduce a lot of the original newspaper articles. It has interviews with people who had sightings, and it has a lot of information. So it's sort of like a really good guidebook for anybody who wants to do further research into Mothman.
Yeah, that's what it was intended for. You know.
And I think it really fits the bill, Jeff. And I want to thank you for coming on the show today.
Okay,
and,
I appreciate it.
Hey, and maybe
you
we'll
can
have
make it to the festival.
Hey, I want to meet you.
I'm sure we'll meet up, yeah.
Yeah, I want to meet you down there. And like I said, I'm gonna do my darndest to make sure I get down there this year. And actually,
okay.
September 18th is my birthday, so it'll be
like
a
nice
little
present.
Yeah, it'll be a nice little birthday present.
I have to announce that to all 5,000 people, you know, when you're there. You know,
maybe I can come on the fly interviews down there with people. Maybe do a little compilation thing.
Yeah, that's what a lot of them do when they come.
Hey, that would be nice. It would give me a chance to meet a lot of the people that are in the field, which would be really great for me.
Yeah, network.
Okay, Jeff. Thanks a lot.
Okay.
I appreciate your time today, and thank you for filling us in on the Mothman. And and we'll catch up with you again. I'll be in touch with you. And
All right.
I'll meet you down there at the festival, hopefully.
Okay. All right.
All
look
right.
forward to it. All right.
Okay.
See ya.
Talk to you later. Bye-bye.
All right. Bye.
Okay. That was Jeff Wamsley. And again, let me remind you that his books can be purchased from his website at mothmanlives.com. And you can link to all the other websites through that one. Mothmanmuseum.com and mothmanfestival.com. You can also find his books on amazon.com. And of course, you know, I had a couple shows with Andy Colvin as well. Andy Colvin is a great researcher into Mothman as well. His books can be found on amazon.com too. And Jeff and Andy know each other as well. So but Jeff spoke Mothman Behind the Red Eyes is a really great resource for doing your own investigation. If you want to like follow up on any of this stuff or look into it a little bit deeper, you can use that as sort of a guide. And then you can go and get some more works like John Keel's and Andy Colvin's and, you know, so many other authors that have looked into this. It's just a really fascinating subject, the giant winged man with the glowing red eyes. And So I want to thank everybody for tuning in today, and remind you that I'll be back here next Friday, 7 to 9 p.m. Eastern Time, and I'll have another episode of The Stench of Truth here on Blog Talk Radio. And don't forget to check out my channel on YouTube. That's youtube.com/user/tenebroust. My show is also called The Stench of Truth on YouTube. Mostly talk about politics and economics and that sort of thing over there, but every once in a while I get into a little bit of the occult and paranormal, which is what this show is all about. I want to thank everybody in the chat room and all the people listening for tuning in today. And also have a new blog, which you can find at tenebroust, T-E-N-E-B-R-O-U-S-T-dash thestenchoftruth.blogspot.com. And I do symbolic breakdowns of movies and have various commentary on news and things like that. It's updated rather infrequently at the moment, but hopefully I'll be doing that on a more regular basis. So you join me here every Friday, 7 to 9 p.m. for another edition of The Stench of Truth. And we'll talk with other paranormal researchers down the road. Some of my guests will include Rosemary Ellen Guiley, Philip Imbrogno. Some of my past guests include Peter Lavenda, Nick Redfern, Greg Bishop, Andy Colvin, of course, and I'll have many more to come down the road. So look forward to some more discussion in the future. And thanks again, everybody. I really appreciate your attendance, and I will talk to you again soon. Have a great night.